Good evening. This is MoTeC on Money, and we're doing it live right here, weeknights in the 5 o'clock hour in the heart of drive time here in Los Angeles. MoTeC on Money, five nights a week for you, live on the air here in 790 KBC, streaming live online worldwide at KBC.com, and the on-demand MoTeC on Money podcast for you at KBC.com, Apple iTunes, all your favorite podcast platforms, and on the socials, too, at Frank MoTeC on X, formerly known as Twitter and Instagram. Choppy day for the stock market today in reaction to the latest reading on inflation, which pretty much came in line with analysts' expectations. Consumer prices up, yep, up by 0.2% last month. And the core rate of inflation, which strips out food and energy, also up 0.2%. And on a year-over-year basis, we see prices up 3.2%, less than the 3.3% expected by most economists, but still higher than the 3% reading from the previous month. And it was the first reacceleration seen in just over a year. The Dow coming in for a closing gain of 53 points, settling at 35,176. The S&P 500 eked out a gain of 1 point, and the NASDAQ gained just about 16 points. In other readings on the economy today, the latest news on unemployment claims showing the number of people in unemployment lines grew last week by 21,000 to 248,000. The earnings parade continued with Disney shares moving up nearly 5% after the media giant reported a mixed third quarter and said it would raise prices on almost all of its streaming packages in an aggressive push to boost profits. Mortgage rates, meanwhile, rising for the third week in a row as the economy showed signs of strength with low employment and a strong wage growth number. Looks like the hot labor summer continues. Now, the guild that represents striking film and television screenwriters says negotiations with major studios and streaming services will resume tomorrow. So that's a big news as we watch what's happening. Thanks to Taylor Swift, when it comes to a recession, L.A. might be able to shake it off. They just concluded six-concert Taylor Swift run at SoFi Stadium, pumped in an estimated $320 million. Into the local economy as Swifties here in Southern California and from around the world came in to see Taylor Swift. Big topic of discussion today at today's State of L.A. Business event organized by the Los Angeles Area Chamber of Commerce at Cal State Dominguez Hills. We'll talk about the Taylor Swift economic boost to the economy and tourism with Adam Burke, the president and CEO of the Los Angeles Tourism and Convention Board. I'll also get his reaction to the other big story impacting tourism worldwide today, the announcement by China lifting a ban on group tours to the United States and other countries. But first, on the markets, the economy, the latest inflation reading, banks back in focus this week, cryptos too. Joining us live now, the former top bank regulator in the United States, the Honorable Brian P. Brooks, the former U.S. Controller of the Currency under President Trump. He's also a crypto expert, has headed up a number of crypto enterprises. Currently, he serves as partner at Valor Capital Group, a $2 billion venture capital fund with a focus on fintech and crypto. Brian P. Brooks, thank you very much for taking the call here this evening, and congratulations on your latest op-ed article, which appeared in the Wall Street Journal this week. First of all, since banks are back in focus, give us your view of things here at the moment.
Hey, well, Frank, it's a great time to have the conversation. You got two or three really big things going on in the banking sector at the moment. First of all, you know, regional banks have seen their stocks fall on average 2 or 3% this week. On news that they've had rating downgrades on their senior debt. That's a bad thing because it means it's more expensive for banks to source capital, and it means that at the margins it's going to be a little bit harder for banks to decide to make loans given that their cost of funds is going to go up. That's a real problem, but it comes as a bit of a double whammy because this week the Federal Reserve Board also announced new capital rules that are likely to make it much more costly for banks to engage in certain kinds of lending. What it means is banks are going to need to hold more of their capital in reserve against future losses, future regulatory fines, and things like that. So, you know, the worry is bank stocks performance is down, but also the availability of credit is going to be a little bit harder to come by in the coming months.
Thank you for explaining that in plain English. It was the Moody's downgrading the credit ratings of 10 small to mid-sized banks, and apparently some others, bigger ones that might be on the list. What is really going on here?
Well, you know, it's a little bit of a puzzle, Frank, and I think there's possibly not full agreement across the big three credit rating agencies on this. But I think the main thing driving bank credit downgrades has to do with commercial real estate. And I think most of your listeners know that in downtown Los Angeles and in a lot of big cities around the country, people never fully came back to work after the COVID pandemic. And as a result of that, you're having leases come due and borrowers defaulting. This is happening all over the country, but with a special focus in Los Angeles and San Francisco. It's a bit of a slow-rolling crisis because your typical lease on an office tower is a 10-year lease, so they don't all fail at once. But as these things come due, it's very, very hard to find new credit on these buildings, which have 30, 40, and even 50% vacancy rates. So until people start going back to work downtown, you're going to have a real problem that sits on bank balance sheets who underwrote a lot of those buildings.
On the air live with the former top U.S. bank regulator, Brian P. Brooks, who served as controller of the currency under President Trump. Let me ask you about that. How kind of a slow-rolling crisis here? How do you expect this to play out? There's been a lot of talk here about repurposing office buildings to turn them into apartments or condos. That, of course, is an often difficult and expensive process. The slow return to the office continues. How do you expect this situation to play out, and might this lead to another financial crisis?
Yeah, Frank, I think it is. First of all, the solution's a lot harder than many people think. You know, it's a lot harder to take an 80-story skyscraper and turn it into an apartment building than you might want. And that has a lot to do with the way that office floor plates are constructed, the interior cores that lack any kind of windows. There are just all kinds of things. You know, fire safety. There are things that make office buildings not generally satisfactory for residential uses. That's not true in all cases, but you can drive down the 110 freeway in Los Angeles and imagine somebody trying to turn the Library Tower or the Ritz-Carlton building into a condo building. That's just a lot harder than you think. What I think is not all banks have the same exposure to that asset class. And the good news is that because it takes a while for those losses to occur, as opposed to the financial crisis where mortgages basically all failed at the same time, it's likely banks will be able to muddle through on some basis, but there will be losses as each one of those buildings sells. You saw this very recently, actually, in Los Angeles, where a building that only 10 years ago had sold for something like $400 million recently resold for something like $70 million. And so you're looking at banks and other people who are foreclosing these properties taking 60, 70, 80% losses. It's going to be a big problem. You're going to see it in bank stocks. And you're going to see it in credit availability going forward. That's really what I'm the most worried about, is can you get a loan in the future? The answer is it's going to be a little bit harder to do that.
It's hard to believe it's been, about 5 months now since we saw those big bank failures this year and then one big bank merger recently. Are there more shoes to drop, you think, in the among the regional banks?
Well, I think there are on that issue, Frank. And it's funny, we're talking about credit downgrades and capital rules. But what happened 5 months ago with Silicon Valley Bank didn't really have anything to do with either credit or capital. What it had to do with was a mismatch between the assets those banks were holding and the cost, of the capital that they were having to hold against those assets. And that was because of the rapid rise in interest rates caused by Federal Reserve monetary policy. The worry I have is that lurking underneath all of these other things you and I just finished talking about, lots of banks still have that exact problem, right? We still have a Fed funds rate that's north of 5%, and these banks still hold a lot of securities that are paying 1%. That means that at any given moment, one of these banks, and when you say small and mid-sized banks, we're still talking about $100 billion banks. That's what qualifies as a small bank in America today. Any one of those banks could fail on the same basis that Silicon Valley did or one of these others. And we seem to have taken our eye off of that ball, and we've started fighting a different fight. So, yes, you're correct. That risk still exists, and bank investors should pay close attention.
Let me ask you about cryptos now, and you have a total command of the subject, and I love the way you explain things in plain English to me and to this audience, and we all appreciate it. I see your latest op-ed article in the Wall Street Journal is titled "Stablecoins Can Keep the Dollar World's Reserve Currency." Blockchain-based assets could be to finance what Voice of America has been to U.S. diplomacy, the article reads. Tell us about your latest article and assessment of what's happening in the crypto world.
Well, Frank, I appreciate that question. There are a lot of things that keep me up at night, unfortunately, because there's just so much to worry about in the world right now. One of the biggest things that everybody ought to be worried about is the rest of the world is engaged in what we call de-dollarization. What that means is most of the world for the last 50 years has settled their trade, they've bought their oil, they've engaged in international finance in dollars. And that is because the dollar was the most stable currency, and after World War II, it was the one ubiquitous currency of the strongest economy on the planet. all of a sudden, big economies around the world, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, are doing everything they can to price their new trade deals in their local currency or sometimes in Chinese currency. And that's a really scary thing for Americans because the dollar's status as a reserve currency is what allows us to borrow cheaply and to finance this massive amount of social spending and infrastructure spending that we're doing in this administration. So a strong dollar in the sense of a reserve currency is really critical. My point in the op-ed in the Wall Street Journal this morning was, even though there are governments that are trying to de-dollarize, what's been really interesting is the people in those countries are clamoring for dollars. And the reason is because inflation in all of those countries is far higher than it is here in the U.S., even in this high inflation environment. But they have no ready ability to save their wages in dollars because they can't get a dollar bank account. That's where stable coins come in. Stable coins are like traveler's checks or prepaid cards. They may not be a bank account, but they are fully backed by dollars. They're redeemable by dollars, and they can be bought on the internet by somebody who doesn't have a U.S. bank account. And so more and more you're seeing residents of these kinds of countries, let alone countries like Venezuela with its 100% inflation rate, wanting to save their money in a dollar equivalent. So the great thing about stablecoins, as I say in the article, is this is a way of the U.S. to communicate its monetary policy to foreign countries that don't want to engage with us on trade or on financial sort of bilateralism. And that's a really good thing. So it's a classic example of crypto actually solving a problem.
How would you advance this then? Would more regulation be required or some sort of a new structure? What are you proposing ultimately here?
Well, the thing is, stablecoins are this very interesting product that currently don't really have a federal regulatory regime. So the best of the stablecoins are backed by treasury securities and dollars. They're immediately redeemable on demand. You know, they function a lot like a bank account does, but that's only because you have a couple of credible companies backing them. There are lots of other companies that aren't particularly credible and aren't subject to any regulation. And so just last week, a very important bill advanced in Congress. It passed through the House Financial Services Committee. But what was disappointing about that was that bill was being drafted by a leadership team of both Republicans and Democrats acting on a bipartisan basis. All of a sudden, on the day of the vote, most of the Democrats, now there were three who didn't do this, but all of the rest of the Democrats on that committee changed their votes, and they decided that they would oppose any kind of regulatory framework for stablecoins. And that's very puzzling because this is a multi-hundred-billion-dollar global market, and the market can only be safe if there's some kind of federal rule around how much has to be held in reserve, what the redemption rules have to be, what kind of disclosures have to be made to purchasers of these stablecoins. If we had that, you could have a very strong foreign dollar market backed by stablecoins. But if we don't have that, certain kinds of people are never going to be.
You love Lala Kent on Vanderpump Rules. Now get to know her on Give Them Lala.
Is it weird having a million things to talk about and the only thing he wanted to talk about is Bravo?
Yes, and it's always weird. It's like when I went to the White House Correspondents' Dinner and thought that this was my chance to like make a change, and they were like, well, enough about change. Scandal. And then I have so many questions for Howie that had nothing to do, and he was like, so scandal.
Give Them Lala, wherever you listen.
Comfortable participating. So this is something that 10 years ago would have been highly bipartisan, but in these very fraught times, even something as simple as stablecoin regulation turns out to be highly partisan, Frank. I wish it weren't so.
And in your term in office as the controller of the currency, you had addressed regulation of cryptos, right, and actually issued crypto charters to banks. What about that, and where do things stand with any more charters and what people should know about that?
Yeah, well, you know, look, Frank, the very first thing that I did on the subject when I was in office was pass a rule that allowed banks to custody the assets that backed stablecoin projects. So it's really just like allowing banks to issue traveler's checks, you know, secured by dollars that are held on deposit. I would have thought that was an obvious thing to do to make this burgeoning asset class much safer. You want that money held in a bank. You don't want it held offshore. You don't want it held in speculative junk bonds or something else. And the Biden administration did not repeal that rule. Indeed, they passed some guidance that endorsed the correctness of our rule. Nonetheless, they haven't allowed any new banks to custody those assets in the 2 years that they've been in office. So again, your guess is as good as mine as to why this is a political issue. I would have thought it was a safety and soundness issue and a consumer protection issue, but, you know, elections have consequences.
Certainly. And let me ask you this, zooming out to the bigger picture here, Bitcoin, of course, gets all the attention. The big dog in the crypto world, hovering just below 30,000 here. We had that so-called crypto winter or crypto ice age last year. What is your assessment of the cryptos here at the moment?
Well, I mean, look, Bitcoin has been the single best performing asset in the world in 2023. So for all people that talk about Bitcoin being dead, it's returned, you know, something like 85% on the year. So if you bought Bitcoin on January 1st, 2023, you're a very happy investor. You know, Bitcoin plays a particular role in the crypto universe, and it's interesting how much it's been talked about during this campaign. You might have noticed that RFK Jr. and Vivek Ramaswamy and Governor DeSantis and a number of other candidates have taken very specific positions on Bitcoin. And the reason they've done that is because of a belief that Bitcoin has the propensity to be sound money. Remember, unlike the Federal Reserve, which can decide to print more money and create more dollars, there can never be more Bitcoin. Bitcoin is created algorithmically and only is produced on a certain rate, and there will never be any more of it. So that means that it's a counterinflationary asset. And in these times, that's an attractive thing. There are some other tokens, you know, that are doing interesting things and building interesting projects on them. But Bitcoin is the story of 2023 for sure.
Let me ask you, who do you think created a Bitcoin?
Frank, I thought it was you. That's what all of my friends have said. Are you telling your listeners
Satoshi,
it wasn't you?
we know the name of somebody there, right? But it's not me. I can tell you that. So
no one really knows. I'll just tease you with this little story as we go out here, which is I was at a dinner a couple of years ago with a group of people who I knew and one person I didn't know. But as the dinner went on, it became clear to me that the person I was with might actually be Satoshi. And the way that other people at this dinner were talking to him, it made clear to me they believed he was Satoshi. So I will not reveal the name, but there was someone who I suspect might have been either the person or part of the group that actually did it. Hard to say.
Wow. Well, we look forward to getting updates on that, and thank you very much. I wish we had more time, as always. Thank you very much for that comprehensive update on what's happening in with the banks and the crypto world, and look forward to our next conversation. The Honorable Brian P. Brooks, the former U.S. Controller of the Currency under President Trump. He's also the partner at Valor Capital Group, a $2 billion venture capital fund with a focus on fintech and crypto. Thank you very much for taking the call live with us here this evening.
Always a pleasure, Frank. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Well, as you just heard, accidents happen. It's jarring to have an accident and hard to think clearly when you're hurt. So my friend, attorney Clark Fielding of Fielding Law, has created something to help you. It's a guide called Be Prepared Before a Motor Vehicle Accident. The guide is one page, fits right there in your glove compartment, and gives you everything you need in case you're hurt in an accident. Go to ClarkTheSharkLaw.com and download your free one-page guide and keep it right there in the glove box. Put Clark Fielding's number in your phone under the word accident. So all you have to do is hit the number when you need him. Tell your family and friends to do the same. So if you're hurt in an accident, call the one we all trust, attorney Clark Fielding, 833-88-SHARK. That's 833-88-SHARK, 833-88-SHARK, and download the Be Prepared Before a Motor Vehicle Accident guide at ClarkTheSharkLaw.com. Again, that's ClarkTheSharkLaw.com. 790 KBC welcomes the Gypsy Kings, featuring Nicholas Reyes at the Greek Theater August 12th. Tickets are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com. And right now, caller 9 wins at 1-888-790-5222. Yep, you can get a pair of tickets to the show if you're caller 9. Call right now, 1-888-790-5222. Motech on Money continues here in 790 KBC. Choppy day for the stock market in reaction to the latest news on inflation. The consumer price number rising by 0.2% in July. Yeah, up again, up 0.2%. And even the core rate, which takes on food and energy, also up 0.2%. Both measures out today coming in line with analysts' expectations. Looks like the consumer price index rose by 3.2%, less than the 3.3% forecast by economists, but higher than the 3% reading the previous month, and it was the first reacceleration of inflation seen in 13 months. What's up, you ask? Well, nothing but the rent. Yep, rent prices continue to surge. The index for rent and owners equivalent rose 0.4% and 0.5% on the monthly basis. Owner's equivalent rent is the hypothetical rent a homeowner would pay. The shelter index was the largest factor in the monthly increase of core inflation. Looks like the energy index decreased 12.5% for the 12 months ending in July, although prices increased 0.1% on an adjusted month-over-month basis. The food index up 4.9% in July over the previous year, with food prices rising 0.2% from June to July. Egg prices down. Here's something to celebrate. Down 2.2% month-over-month after dropping 7.3% in June and nearly 14% in May. Well, the Dow did come in for a closing gain today of 53 points. The S&P 500 moved up 1. The NASDAQ gained 16. The yield in the 10-year note has shot higher again to 4.11%. Mortgage rates have moved up for the third week in a row. That yield in the 10-year note is the one that impacts the fixed-rate mortgage rates out there. In the crypto space, we see a Bitcoin up about $30 now at $29,471, Ethereum up 3 at $1,851, and Doge at 7 cents. Gold settling nearly flat today, after hours down about $4.50 now at $1,944.40 an ounce. Motec on Money continues here on 790 KBC. We're doing it live here in the 5 o'clock hour on 790 KBC. And turns out the IRS lost millions of taxpayer files and was caught storing sensitive data cartridges on open shelves in a warehouse, according to a new report out from the IRS watchdog agency. Let's bring in another watchdog for American taxpayers, the director of Americans for Tax Reform, Matt Pallotz, live with us here now. Matt, give us your reaction to this report here, first of all.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. And again, what we have here is a continued pattern of IRS abuse and misuse of taxpayer documents. I think a lot of people have been familiar with it before. We've had leaks of sensitive taxpayer information to progressive media outlets like ProPublica. Another pattern we've seen is the continued misuse of taxpayer information in terms of storage, losing taxpayer documents. So today we had a new report out from the Treasury Inspector General that's the internal watchdog for the IRS, and found that they're missing millions of taxpayer documents, and specifically warning that this is information that can be used to commit tax fraud for refunds and identity theft.
Isn't that something? So what recourse does Mr. and Mrs. USA have, average taxpayer have in the face of this situation when they're dealing with missing records or misplaced records there that the IRS is supposed to be holding?
Well, this is the deeply concerning part, is that there isn't much recourse to be had, because what we have is right now is a situation of which the IRS can't even tell us whose taxpayer documents that are missing. So imagine that you're a tax filer, you're going through a dispute with the IRS, you're trying to get your refund back, and the IRS has lost your documents, and they can't even confirm that it's your documents that they've lost. So unfortunately, we're in a situation where we have a massive expansion of the IRS from Congress under the Biden administration, where we've handed them $80 billion to go increase audits of American taxpayers without ensuring that they have the same capabilities to, one, even secure the information that they're already collecting, and two, that while increasing audits, they're going to be able to keep pace with the necessary insurances that they can give taxpayers that they're actually even able to manage disputes when they're losing the taxpayer documents they're already collecting.
Now, this latest incident is on top of what happened a while ago, and I believe you reported this to us as well, that the IRS purposely destroyed about 30 million taxpayer files without telling anyone about that. Where does that situation stand?
Yeah, of course. And this is something that happened, was first reported back on, I believe, in 2021. We still have no answers since then. There's been congressional investigations into this. The IRS has testified on this, but they have no answer for why at a processing facility out in Utah, they destroyed 30 million active taxpayer documents. They can't tell us how they destroyed it, whether that's incineration, shredding, burying, or just dumping them out in a river somewhere. We don't know what happened to them. They can't tell us how they destroyed 30 million taxpayer documents. All we know is that they did do it. And again, this is the same type of thing. Imagine if you're going through a dispute with the IRS and we're giving the IRS increasing power at the time where they cannot manage the tasks that they have now and can't complete the basic tasks that they have that they're supposed to do on behalf of taxpayers.
All right. And now this idea of an IRS free file tax return plan, where does that stand at this point?
Yeah. So, of course, while we have all this going on, we have new roles being assigned to the IRS. We've heard a lot about the idea that the IRS is going to start coming after Venmo and PayPal payments. That'll happen at the end of this year if we don't have congressional action, that anyone who's paid over $600 will start having their Venmo and PayPal transactions looked at by the IRS. In addition to that, we have the IRS attempting to take over the tax preparation business. So we had Democrat funding for essentially what is a study and pilot program for the IRS to begin creating its own software. This is the same IRS that has the Inspector General report coming out saying that they're not safeguarding the information that they have, that they're leaving taxpayers vulnerable to identity theft and refund fraud. This is the same organization that wants to take over the entire tax preparation business, which at a minimum should be a concern for taxpayers, that you don't want the same person who's going to come audit you and who manages contested audits to be the same person who's filing taxes on behalf of you. Obviously, the IRS, obviously the government has an incentive to demand that you owe them the most money as possible. They don't have your best interest in heart or trying to get you the best refund possible.
So where does that stand? Some of the big tax preparation companies are fighting that, right?
That's correct. And right now, currently, I believe there has already been a study conducted that was found by the New America Foundation, which is a left-leaning institution that was selected to conduct the study without really any competing offers to do it. They themselves would be a potential vendor should the IRS decide to move forward with tax preparation software. So they hired a group to do it that's both left-leaning politically and also would be a potential person who would develop the software that they would move forward with. So obviously an unbiased source for a study. And then currently we have there's some proposals from House Republicans trying to zero out or prevent any funding from being used for the creation of a pilot program. So we have the House Republicans in a bit of a butting heads with the IRS over this specific issue right now.
Very interesting. And of course, curiously, we saw the Fitch rating agency downgrade Uncle Sam's credit rating recently. And also they took aim at the mortgage giants Fannie and Freddie. And then we had another rating agency take a look at the regional banks and even the bigger banks. What's going on there in Washington?
Yeah, I think what we're seeing right now is just you're piling up the consequences of what's been runaway spending from the Biden administration, specifically since COVID. That spending has had consequences that Americans have seen in terms of the inflation and rising costs. I think we're roughly at the point now where your dollars were 16% of what it was when Biden took office, and now we're seeing the broader complications of that of borrowing money at such an expensive at such a rate that now we're seeing America's credit downgraded, which is something that fuels the cost of borrowing money that in itself will further fuel inflation.
Right. So people need to pay attention to what's going on here. Any more shoes to drop? And are you picking up any more intelligence on any more credit rating downgrades or anything else that might be down the pike here?
Well, we're just waiting to see what drops right now, but it's obviously something that's concerning, something that Americans and taxpayers should have their eye on. It's I think, thankfully, at least being accepted by the public now, that you can't just spend money without consequences. And unfortunately, it's been American consumers and taxpayers that are facing that now.
Certainly, the unofficial slogan of the IRS has been, we've got what it takes to take what you've got, right? Going back to that Venmo and PayPal story, where does that stand here with transactions of $600 or more being examined? What's happening there on Capitol Hill to address that proposal?
Yeah, so anyone unfamiliar, this is a rule change that Democrats made back in March of 2021. This is part of the first, what was supposed to be the COVID relief package. One of the only revenue-raising measures in that bill was this new threshold that if you have Venmo and PayPal transactions over $600, you're going to get a tax form called a 1099-K, which is going to give about 20 million people the idea that they owe additional taxes, a tax form that they've never received in their life. Before this, and regardless of whether or not you've actually paid those taxes, that was actually income. So think of a situation, you had a sporting event or a concert and you sold tickets even at a loss, it'll be up on you to prove that that wasn't taxable income. That's something you're going to have to deal with Uncle Sam. And that situation right now is set to kick in this January if there's no further congressional action delaying it. So this is something that's only months away from people having to deal with. It'll be a huge item come next tax season if we don't see action from Congress to try and fix this.
Is there any action from Congress to fix it?
There are. There is a bill right now from Carol Miller, who's a congresswoman from West Virginia, that fully restores the threshold, what used to be $20,000 rather than the $600 reporting threshold now, as well as the number of Venmo and PayPal transactions you have to have, which was 200 transactions previously. Democrats took that to no number of transactions. Just if you have more than $600, you're going to get this 1099-K form. And this is also part of the major Ways and Means House Republican tax package right now that's expected to be taken up in September that would fix this as well.
It's great that you know all that and our watchdog there in Washington. Anything else that's under the radar screen that the public should know about?
I think we've covered a lot so far, but I definitely would keep your mind and focus on this Venmo PayPal issue. If this doesn't get fixed by January, it'll be a major tax issue.
All right, Matt. Well, thanks very much for taking the call on this important issue tonight and that shocking report from the IRS watchdog agency itself that the IRS lost millions of taxpayer files and was caught storing sensitive information on open shelves in a warehouse.
Thank you.
Folks, is your knee pain keep getting worse? How about that pain in your shoulder or hip or back? Don't let them tell you steroids and surgery are your only options. Take my advice now and call QC Kinetics. Frank Motek here. QC Kinetics can make that pain go away with all-natural advanced regenerative medicine. They're helping people here every day with these amazing natural treatments that restore and repair your damaged joint tissue. It's like turning back the clock. Regenerative medicine uses concentrated healing agents from your very own body to stimulate the damaged tissue in your joints so they work like they're supposed to, and there's zero downtime. QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in this exciting medical breakthrough. Patients here are getting real lasting relief and are saying no to surgery and drugs. If you have pain due to injury or arthritis, this is a remarkable option that you need to check out, and the consultation is absolutely free. QC Kinetics, locations in Glendale, the city of Orange, Mission Viejo, and now also in Costa Mesa. Call 213-997-PAIN. 213-997-PAIN. Again, that's 213-997-PAIN.
It's a rich man's world.
Motek on Money continues here on 790 KBC. The new economic engine of Los Angeles, Taylor Swift, contributing about $320 million to the local economy during her concert tour, which has just wrapped up. Tourism has become big again here in Los Angeles, and joining me now is Adam Burke, the president and CEO of the Los Angeles Tourism and Convention Board, who just presented at the State of LA Business event that was presented by the LA Area Chamber of Commerce. Adam Burke, thank you very much for joining us. Tell us what you told this important audience here tonight.
Well, first of all, you're exactly right about Taylor Swift. It's these type of mega events that really are helping to accelerate the pace of recovery. I think what's important for people to know, first of all, is just that tourism is one of the biggest drivers of our local economy. Right now, there are over 550,000 Angelenos who earn their livelihood in tourism-related careers. And, you know, the good news is domestic leisure travel is coming back strong, but we're probably another 24 to 36 months away from full recovery, particularly from our critical overseas markets.
Tell us about the impact of Taylor Swift, first of all, and that fabulous tour. What, anecdotally, obviously was a tremendous boost here to the tourism economy.
You're exactly right. And the way we always describe it is LA has to be red carpet ready. Because when you think about the type of events that we have year-round, whether it be the college football playoffs, whether you have the U.S. Men's Open out at the LA Country Club, Taylor Swift, Beyonce is going to be doing four shows at SoFi Stadium, not to mention award shows, major sporting events, conventions. Year-round, those types of events are driving economic impact and job creation to literally every neighborhood and household of Los Angeles.
That's terrific. And, of course, the other big news today, China reopening tourism, right, allowing group tours to the United States again. Give us your reaction to that big news here.
That is long-awaited and incredibly exciting news, Frank. I think people may recall that in 2019, China was actually LA's number one overseas market. We had over 1.2 million Chinese visitors in Los Angeles, and that made it our number one overseas. It also meant that LA saw one out of every three Chinese visitors to the U.S.
That's impressive. Where are the other visitors coming in from here in Los Angeles these days?
So if you look at the markets closest to home, it's going to be an uneven recovery. We expect that Canada and Mexico will be fully recovered this year. Beyond that, even if China only recovers to about 40% of 2019, that would make it our top overseas market. But the other markets where we are investing heavily are Australia, New Zealand, UK, Ireland, and then right behind that, France, Germany, South Korea, and Japan.
A lot of discussion here about planning for the future, including the events that you just mentioned, including, it's hard to believe, right around the corner, 2028 with the Olympics. Tell us how you're preparing for it.
Well, I think the good news is, and this is one of the reasons why I think LA was such a logical choice, is that we are not having to build any new infrastructure or capacity for the games. I think that's one of the reasons why LA is one of the only Olympics ever to not only turn a profit, but to this day, a lot of people may not know that the LA 84 Foundation is still funding youth sports programs across the region. So for us, it's just an incredible spotlight to showcase our destination around the world. And one of the things that I think really is a testament to LA, LA will become the first and only U.S. city to have hosted the games three times, and along with London and Paris, one of only three global destinations to do so.
It's going to be amazing to see all that Olympic imagery coming out of Los Angeles once again, as we saw last time here in 84 with Rayford Johnson lighting the Olympic cauldron. So lots to look forward to here.
100%. And I think the other thing people should remember is we're also hosting the Paralympic Games. And when you think about LA being really one of the most diverse and inclusive communities worldwide, it's recognizing that everyone is welcome. And I think that's one of the reasons it remains such a preferred destination. People from all walks of life can feel completely at home in Los Angeles.
All right. And we got some other big issues here. The hot labor summer continues. There are some labor actions in front of some of the hotels. Tell us what's happening there.
For that, actually, the best person to talk to would be Heather Roseman from the Hotel Association of Los Angeles. She's really been focused on that. But, you know, certainly our hope is that everyone finds an equitable solution and that we move forward as quickly as possible.
Certainly. Any new hotels or any other things on the drawing board to prepare for the influx of all of our great visitors here?
We're actually really fortunate from that perspective. You know, the old joke about if you want to know where to buy a house, look where they're building a Whole Foods and a Home Depot. I look at a market in terms of developer confidence, and remarkably, in the last 24 months, we added 5,000 new hotel rooms in LA, and we desperately need that inventory as we start to see markets rebound, especially internationally. So you not only have this influx of new lifestyle and boutique hotels, but you've got these incredible new projects. Obviously, SoFi Stadium in Hollywood Park, the Academy Museum of Motion Pictures, Destination Crenshaw will be making its debut in the first quarter of 24, and the Lucas Museum right behind it in 25. So it's just remarkable the level of investment in our community.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much for that comprehensive update on the important tourism industry here in Los Angeles. That is Adam Burke, the president and CEO of Los Angeles Tourism and Convention Board. And hopefully Taylor Swift will get back here as soon as possible, right?
She can't come back soon enough for us.
Terrific. Thank you very much for joining us here on MoTeC on Money on 790 KABC.
Thanks so much, Frank. Have a great day.
All right. Thank you again very, very much for watching the hot labor summer continue to play out. Some big news here today involving the Writers Guild strike against the studios. The guild that represents the striking film and television screenwriters says negotiations with the major studios and streaming services will resume tomorrow. The Writers Guild of America sent a message to its members today saying they expect the studios will respond to their proposals. The two sides met last week to discuss possibly restarting negotiations, but no negotiation dates were immediately set. The Writers Guild of America will resume negotiations with the studios on Friday, according to Variety. This according to a guild email, the Alliance of Motion Picture and TV Producers set to deliver a response to the guild's proposal, according to the union. So we're watching that situation very, very closely. Also, according to the Daily Beast, on the heels of Real Housewives alum Bethany Frankel urging reality stars to organize for better wages and working conditions, SAG-AFTRA released a statement today acknowledging the exploitive practices that have developed in this area. In the words of the union, the guild added that it will now work toward the protection of the reality performers and engage in a new path to union coverage. We're on the story. We'll be back again tomorrow evening, the 5 o'clock hour here. Missed any part of the program tonight? Catch the MoTeC on Money podcast on demand at kabc.com. This is MoTeC on Money on 790 KBC.